Who wouldn't have? Paul.
I Pray with me. O God of the covenant, in the glory of the cross, your Son embraced the power of death and broke its hold over your people. In this time of repentance, draw all people to yourself, that we who confess Jesus as Lord may put aside the deeds of death and accept life in your kingdom. Amen. God is good.
Every day.
I know, wait a minute. We're going to have to practice. I'll practice turning on my mic. Is that better? Is that what this means, Anthony? I believe we got one more here today than we had last Sunday. Is that right, Anthony?
Yes.
It is wonderful to see all of you here inside the sanctuary. And to those online and those in the parking lot listening, we welcome you here to Sunday. And we're going to try it one more time. I'm going to say, God is good. You're going to say all the time. And I'm going to say all the time. You're going to say, God is good. Ready? God is good.
All the time.
All the time. All right. We got it. I just love seeing y'all here today, and this is the second Sunday in Lent, meaning there are just 35 days left until Easter Sunday. This is the last day of February, can you believe that? Peggy, is it true that the older I get, the faster the years go by, is that right? I think I was 75 for about 6 months. It just seems to go by. How many of you have had both vaccinations here today? All right, how many have had just one? We are getting there. You know, the program is continuing each week, and more of us are approaching immunity, we think, depending on what Dr. Fauci tells us. But we want to get back, try to get back to normal. Whatever that is, I know that one dose is better than no doses, and two is better than one, and both of them are better than none. So, we've got next Friday, we have a sign that our church is coming back. Next Friday afternoon, well, Friday evening late, we have a troop of Boy Scouts coming in from Pine Mountain, Georgia. They're going to spend Friday night and Saturday night in our fellowship hall. There are going to be about 15 of them, and they're going to go skiing at Cataloochee. So they're going to call me. They're not going to leave Pine Mountain until about 7 o'clock on Friday evening, so they're going to call me when they hit the state line. I'll be in Franklin, probably asleep by the time they get there. And I'm going to come over and let them in. Pam and Vicki are going to be working on, we're not going to just let them come in here and stay, are we? We'd have something for them to eat when they get here, some drinks and all that. Do you want to make some cookies or do something like, Carol, you want to make a batch of cookies? Would you get with one of them after services today? And they, you know, we'll try to coordinate all that sort of stuff.
Are they going to eat breakfast here too?
No, we're going to have, what we're going to do is we're going to have, imagine they're going to get going pretty early on Saturday morning. I think the lift opens at 8:30. So what we're going to do, we're going to have when they come Friday night, we're going to have cookies and peanut butter and jelly sandwiches and all that sort of stuff. And then on, we'll also have donuts and orange juice and that sort of stuff that they can have the next morning. So, and then we'll come over on Saturday and kind of clear up the wreckage and then set it up for Saturday night again. There's going to be about 15 of them. They're real excited. I'm really excited that we're going to have something going on here.
What's the menu for Saturday night?
Saturday night? They're going to ski till 10 o'clock. So, same kind of deal. They're boys, and you know, I said, all we've got is hard fours, and they said, doesn't matter, we do it all the time, and we've got pads and sleeping bags. And I said, and we don't have any showers. He said, these are a bunch of boys. So, so I'm glad I'm not going to be riding in the van back with them on Sunday morning. But I think that it's, I think that it's wonderful that we're having that. So get in touch with them and see what you, if you want to do something. I'll put all of you, reading the Lenten readings that you have gotten. If you haven't gotten a copy of them, they're available to you right at the side over here. And if you need to get one online, if you go to whittierumc.org, you can download a copy over there. And if you're worried about starting late, don't worry. You can just start tomorrow. I've just finished up week one, and you can start on week two. I had a long talk with a lady you can't have a short talk with. That was Brenda Shook. And Jeannie, would you take a copy of this and put it in her mailbox? She knew all about it. She's watching this online. She said, I love your red jacket.
Oh,
it's your war on Valentine's
so
Day.
She's home
now. She's home now.
Okay.
And
I'll just walk up and put it inside her door.
Yeah. So, well, it was funny. She told me, she said, now I can move around. She said, I can go out on my front porch, but I have to spend the rest of my life out there because I can't get up the step to get back in the house.
Yeah.
So I'm just thrilled. I've not met this lady, but I just can't wait to meet her. But would you take a copy of this to her?
Sure.
Put one right there. I promised you, too, that I was going to preach. Every Sunday I'll preach from something you read during the week. And today's sermon about Nicodemus is going to be in the scripture that if you're reading this, in the scripture that you read yesterday and the week after that. So, do we have any other announcements? Kathy, would you give us some beautiful music? happens to be my favorite hymn. And you knew that, didn't you, Kathy?
Have you heard how that song came about?
Yes, we just read about that. About the man and all that stuff. Wasn't that just on Facebook, or did you give that to me, Vicki? All the bad things that had happened to him. And still, it is well with my soul. I've checked. We're still not allowed by the conference to be singing in church. I'm not sure that what it is. I can't wait until we can sing again. I guess I was doing a duet there. I was kind of singing along with it because it is well with my soul today. Thank you so much for that, Kathy. We come to the part of our service where we remember those who are in need and praises for those who have been served by the Lord. Pam Koch's sister, Joanne Hyatt, passed away last week. And I talked to Pam about it, and her sister, Joanne, was quite a bit older than her. In fact, Pam grew up with her sister's children. But she was 84 years old, and she passed away, and we sent our prayers to Pam and her family. Brenda Shook, I've talked to you about. She's at home. She's doing well. She's just got to get her strength back. She's able to talk fine, but she's got to be able to get up and walk around. And she's really looking forward. And Brenda, I know that you're watching this today. And I thank you for watching. And I hope you like this jacket, too. I'll wear my red one again on Pentecost. So we're glad you're getting better. We just surely would like to see you here sitting in the sanctuary. Even Al and Jack Howard, Judy, how are they doing?
Jack was taken back to the hospital this weekend. He is retaining a lot of fluid. He's a big man anyway.
Right.
And he was having trouble breathing, so I don't know if it's pneumonia. I don't know if this goes along with him. You know, he can't do anything but sit in a chair.
Right.
He's not able to move around. But keep even Al in your prayers. She came to the food pantry Saturday. Well, she just worked like a Trojan. And we always look forward to her coming. And I want to say one other thing about a former member here, Mrs. Abilene McLean. That was one of her favorite songs. She was a blind lady.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sorry you weren't around when she was around. She lived to be about 90. Peg, did that remind you of Abilene?
Yes.
Yeah.
I think Peggy was enjoying that too, weren't you? Charles Martin, how's he doing?
I tried to call yesterday and I couldn't get through to him, so I really don't know any status on him right now. But I do have a concern. I affiliate with the Bryson City United Methodist Church for Sunday
right.
School.
Mm-hmm.
And this morning, Christine Taylor, she is fellowships with him too. Out of Walnut Creek, North Carolina, which is about 30 miles north of Winston-Salem, and she's going through a hard time. This girl has seemed like every week is back in the hospital. She's dehydrated. Her blood pressure is out of the world low, and she's got a lot of problems. She's a nurse by training and everything, and we all praying for her through that church, and we'd, I like for us to pray to her through this church.
Would you just let her know that this little church up here in Whittier, North Carolina is praying for her?
Well, she'll appreciate that.
Have an old friend. When you say somebody's an old friend, and especially if it's a lady, that's the wrong thing. I should say a longtime friend.
Friend.
In Fort Myers, Florida, his name is Gail Black. They called me last night to ask for prayers. Gail has they discovered a melanoma on her back, and she's going to have surgery on the 17th of March, and ask that we pray for her. So we're going to pray all over the country. Yeah.
Yeah, I have some concerns for George and myself. We have several doctor's appointments coming up this week, our urologist and orthopedic surgeon for me, and neurologist and ENT for him. So keep us in your prayers.
said they were having surgery on March 17th. I'm told not to, to mention in front of you that daylight saving time's on the 14th of March, right? So we remember that. I'll give you a reminder. I'll probably give you a call like I did this morning. I'll give you a call and say, hey, it's an hour earlier. You need to get out of bed. I call you. I waited until 9:15 this morning to call everybody. I'll call at 6 on that morning.
You're out of your mind.
Anyone else?
Joyce is doing this. It's really a joy because yesterday morning she called her husband, got hold of her phone in the hospital, called her husband and said, why aren't you here with me? And this woman has come turn the corner. She's been in the hospital for 2 months with COVID. So she's finally turning the corner. So
oh, that's wonderful. Joy.
She's so appreciative that everyone is still praying. Our young friend Ty is doing good. He got his staples out. Just a long
Ty Hagman from the waterboarding accident.
Wakeboarding. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But he's doing well. So thank you so much. And I know our prayers are working. So.
Prayers work.
Yes, they do.
And you can't get too many of them. Somebody asked me that one time. Well, if you got one person praying, God is aware. So what does everybody need to pray? Because it counts. It counts, and the more the better. Judy, did you?
This is kind of hard to say. Rita and I have a relative, John Martin, who has had a law practice building. He had to discontinue his law practice because he has cancer, and he's been fighting it about 2 years. So this morning when I came by, the ambulance was there, which is nothing new. He's in and out of the hospital. I don't think he eats food. He gets this infusion called a banana bag. I think it's potassium. Mm-hmm. But I stopped the car and went across the railroad tracks, and he walked out with his cane and laid down in the chair for the ambulance, and I kissed him, and I said, John, you get better.
You tell him we're praying for him.
I will. So they left with him going to Swain, and the nurse with him, I said, how's it going? And she said, it's bad. I said, I'm going to church, and she said, I'm not sure that John is a believer. So please keep him in your prayers. His mother was in this church many, many years and then moved to Bryson and then came back. Everybody knew Verna Parton, and John is the only son left. Mike, he has a sister, and I think the other boys have passed away, so he remembered. I said, John, I put a card on your door the other day. He said, I got it. So,
yeah, well,
keep Johnny in your prayer.
We take to remember him. Anyone else?
Yes, this week is Levi's birthday. The other day, poor Ethan Blessing.
Anthony. Thank you.
The fourth is Levi's birthday, and poor Ethan. He got his new car, and he kind of had a little bumped into the curb. And I think he was less worried about the car. He was more worried about what his mom, old man and old woman, you know, was going to say about it. He's worked real hard to get to the whole insurance, so there's that. But I also, if y'all could remember the name Reef Cochran. He was on our wrestling team, and he only won one match, but he won it because the guy let him win. And the only thoughts I have to say is that Jesus didn't ask much of us, he just said to love. That's all he did, he just said to love. And that when that love is given, that we somehow are able to receive that love. And he made a decision that maybe there was no love for him. I want you to remember that, child.
Thank you, Anthony. Anyone else? You're going to leave time now for me to preach, right?
Sasha?
Uh-huh.
She's
both, these are in Alabama, the Dora Police Department and the Walker County Sheriff's Department both had officer-involved shootings yesterday, which these are small little towns, little places like here in Whittier and Bryson City. And this, they don't have that a lot, and they've had two this weekend.
Wow.
In that area. And so for the officers involved, the families of the, you know.
Officers and families, yeah.
And the families of the victims, the kind of all around, I guess for the whole town, that's the kind of thing that's gonna shock the whole town. That's where my daughter lives and got married last weekend.
Anyone else? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Kind and gracious Heavenly Father, as you send Abraham out to a new place and a new land, so you invite us to anticipate worlds and realms beyond our imaginations. As we journey in faith in this Lenten season, bless us with your presence that our new life and our new birth may be as real as the day we call today. Father, today we grieve the loss of a precious sister, Joanne Hyatt. Lord, we know that she is in your arms in paradise. And we pray that you will bring comfort and assurance to the members of her family who remain here and await reunion with her in your heaven. Lord, there are many others that we have held up today and all sorts of needs. Lord, today we pray just your special attention and mercy to these friends, family and acquaintance, all your lambs, Lord. Lord, would you bring them comfort and healing? Lord Jesus, as you taught Nicodemus heavenly things, give us ears to hear your heavenly word and a heart to accept your grace of a new birth from above. As you were lifted upon the cross for us, so lift our hearts in faith that we may have eternal life. Lord, in this season of Lent, keep our hearts turned toward recognition of our sins. Repent for these sins. Keep our minds towards that glorious day when we recognize the light of your resurrection on Easter Sunday. Hear us now, Lord, as we pray in the manner that Jesus has taught us. When we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now will you stand and join with me in the affirmation of our faith? Stand if you're able. Join in the affirmation of our faith, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come and judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Okay. Our scripture this morning comes from the book of John, the third chapter, verses 1 through 18. And this is the scripture you had yesterday. And the name of the scripture is Jesus Teaches Nicodemus. Would you stand, if you're able, for the reading of the gospel? Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know you're a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the miraculous signs you're doing if God were not with him." In reply, Jesus declared, "I tell you the truth. No one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again." "How can a man be born again when he is old?" Nicodemus asked. "Surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb to be born." Jesus answered, "I tell you the truth. No one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and of the Spirit. Flesh gives flesh, birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to the Spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it's going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit." "How can this be?" Nicodemus asked. "You're Israel's teacher," said Jesus, "and you do not understand these things? I tell you the truth. We speak of what we know, and we testify to what we have seen," we mean himself. "But still you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things, and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever gone to heaven except the one who has come from heaven, the Son of Man." Here's a familiar verse. "Just as Moses lifted up a snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life." Wow. "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his own Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to
God. Pretty neat scripture, huh? This particular scripture describes one of the linchpins of what we believe. The linchpin of our hope, of our eternity. But lots of folks don't want to hear about it. Something else that sometimes is tougher for folks. And all we know about Nicodemus is what's told us in the book of John in the Bible, where it just said, we just read it, he was a Pharisee. The Pharisees were a group of Jews who were fastidious in keeping the letter of the law. They believed that they practiced a religion which was observance of the law. Now, when I say the law, does anybody have any idea what we're talking about, the law? Are we talking about the Ten Commandments? No, they had fleshed that out a little bit. At the time of Jesus, when the Pharisee asked him, what's the most important commandment? There were 633. And the Pharisees were responsible for saying that you followed the letter of the law. And they opposed Jesus throughout his ministry. They spent most of their time trying to catch him in a blasphemous act. Saul of Tarsus, who later became a guy we call Paul, was also a Pharisee, and as was Martha, the sister of Lazarus, who was a Pharisee. It's not exactly the same, but think of them as being Baptists, and the Sanhedrin, not Sanhedrin, the Sadducees being Methodists. It was kind of like a sect. And they did believe, the Pharisees believed strongly in an afterlife of some sort where everyone would be raised up on the last day. Nicodemus was also described as a leader of the Jews. He was a member of the Sanhedrin, which was the ruling body of the Jews. The Sanhedrin in Jerusalem was the final court of appeals for matters concerning the law. It was like our Supreme Court. This was the body that ultimately condemned Jesus, yet they had to get Pilate to approve their condemnation because under Roman law, they were not allowed to kill anyone, execute anyone. In an offer today, but later in John 7 and 19, you can read about how Nicodemus actually defended Jesus. And how when Joseph of Arimathea got permission to take Jesus' body, and took it to his own tomb, and when he prepared, Nicodemus came and helped prepare Jesus' body and contributed 75 pounds of spices, which was a huge amount of money, to embalm the body and help Joseph wrap it. So this guy, this most unlikely, needs to see Jesus. He comes to speak to him at night. Why did he come tonight? Because he didn't want to be seen talking to this guy by anybody, so he came at night. There comes Nicodemus seeking out Jesus of Nazareth, who, to say the least, is distrusted by the Sanhedrin. Here comes this Pharisee who opens up not with a question. He didn't ask a question, but he opens up with a declaration. He says, you must be from God, otherwise you wouldn't be able to do all of these things that you have done. John never tells us what it is that Nicodemus really wants to ask Jesus. But it does look like something's known at him, doesn't it? I mean, why would he come there? Based on what he's seen this guy Jesus do, he knows there must be something else going on that he's not aware of. He knows there's something about Jesus that he can't see. There's more to him than what he knows or what he can see, something that's just not physical. There's so many questions on Nicodemus' mind. That's why he went. There are questions of faith and life and spirit and heaven and purpose. But Jesus never lets him ask that first question. He just gives him an answer. And the answer that addresses all questions, all of his questions. Jesus pretty much said this, Nicodemus, stop. Here's the bottom line. You must be born again. And if you're not born again, he says, you'll never even see the kingdom of God. And if trying to live a good life is not going to get it, memorizing the law isn't going to get it, you must be born of God. If you want the life I'm offering, if you want to go to heaven, if you want that hole that you have in your soul, if you want that filled, once and for all, you must be born again. Now think about who he's telling this to. This is a revered man, a leader, a religious man. He's a religious man, he's a theological expert, but he can't understand the most basic spiritual truth. All he can see is the impossibility of the physical truth. Well, this can't be done, be born again. He could not grasp the spiritual reality of what Jesus was saying. You must be born again. Do you grasp that? You must be born again. I hope so, because that's the underlying reality of our salvation. The underlying reality of our salvation is must be born again. You know, Jesus points out to Nicodemus that there's a physical reality and a spiritual reality, a tangible reality and an intangible reality. And he again, kingdom Jesus speaks of is a spiritual kingdom. That's why later in John 18 he says, my kingdom is not of this world. You know, in the same way that a person must be physically born in the flesh, if they are to exist in the natural world, a person can't exist in the kingdom of God or in the supernatural world unless they're born from above, spiritually. There's a natural birth and a supernatural birth. There's a human birth and a spiritual birth that Jesus is talking about. Nicodemus just says this. How is that possible? How does that work? I mean, I just can't get it. It won't fit. I mean, how do we possibly do that, be born again? And as religious as he was, he just doesn't get it. Jesus says, you don't understand spiritual things because you're not spiritually alive, Nicodemus. My mother attended First Methodist Church, but later became First United Methodist Church. She came from Fredericksburg, Virginia. She married her cousin. That's what's wrong with me. Moved to Fort Myers, and am I in the, okay, Captain?
There you go.
One of these days we won't have to do, I'm sorry. First United Methodist Church, 58 years. For 58 years, she sat in the same pew, right where you are, Judy, sat in the same pew. The light didn't go on in that church building unless she was there. At the circle, I remember her talking about sewing bandages during World War II. Altar guild, all of that. She was always there. About 2 weeks before she died, I was with her in the hospital, and I gathered up my courage, and I said, Mother, have you been saved? Mother, are you born again? She said, I always thought that was for those Church of God people, those Holy Rollers. 58 years, she said. Of course, within the next hour, we prayed together, and she begged Jesus to forgive her of her sins and to become her own personal Savior. She did it again the next day when the preacher came, just to make sure that it got done right, that I hadn't done it wrong. And she told me this. She said, I finally, now I'm sure, Mom, you're going to forgive me for doing this, for telling on you. She said, I finally understand that joke that the preacher told last month. And I said, what joke was that? He said, going to spending 1 hour in a church every Sunday doesn't make you a Christian any more than spending 1 hour in a garage on Sunday makes you an automobile. Meaning, you have to be born again. Now, if you watch out, because a lightning bolt may come down from heaven. Sorry, Mom. You know, being religious doesn't mean that you understand the spiritual truth. Being religious doesn't fill that empty spot in your soul or satisfy that longing in your heart. You can have a biological life and be ridiculous, be religious, but that doesn't mean that you have a spiritual life. You know, we're created for both. God created us to be physically alive and to be spiritually alive, so we have to be physically born and spiritually born. And there you have the meaning of born again, both physically born and then born again, spiritually in Christ Jesus. One life's temporary, the other's eternal. Have you ever heard this said? If you're born once, you die twice. If you're born twice, you die once. That comes from John of Patmos in Revelation. It says this, if you are born once in the physical, You die twice. You die to your physical body, and then you die to the grace of God for eternity. You die twice. If you're born twice, once physically and once born again in Christ Jesus, your physical body dies, and then you never die again. You receive the grace of Jesus Christ and God for eternity. The answer to all of Nicodemus' questions are Jesus' simple statement. You must be born again. That's the simple, the starting place. Spiritual life begins there. Unless you're born a second time, until you're born from above, you're born of God's Spirit, your deepest longings will never be met, and your profound questions will never be answered. Nothing else mattered, and Nicodemus and us have to address that spiritual truth. Whatever questions you have about God, Jesus, or the Bible, life or heaven, hell, it begins here, being born again. You didn't see it on the screen, but my Bible, all of this that I'm talking to you right now, my Bible is printed in red. These are the words of Jesus Christ. I'm just explaining to you what he said. You know, verse 14, Nicodemus goes back to the Exodus story. Remember, was everybody here last week remembers that? About the people of Israel, you know, getting bitten by the snakes. And he said, I'll take the snakes away. And God said, make a bronze snake and put it on a pole. And anybody that looks at that pole will be cured from the snake bite. But the snake stayed. And Jesus said in this verse 14, he says, just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, so that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. Jesus was telling Nicodemus something. He tried to do all this life to live a good life. And he was telling Nicodemus that even he, again, imagine the majesty of this Pharisee, that even he needed to be born again. That being born again happens only by faith, by looking up at the Son of Man on the cross. To please God, you must be born again. To receive all the promises he has for you, you must be born again. To be in a relationship with Jesus, you must be born again. And this is what Jesus says, not me. To go to heaven, you must be born again. John 3:16. Has anybody heard of that? Now you have some Bible trivia you can talk to your friend. You ask somebody, Carol, say, hey, you know John 3:16? Jesus said that, right? Ask me, who did he say it to? Nicodemus. Well, think about what it says. Whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Is that true? Is that all that's necessary, just to believe in him? Is that it? Just to believe in him? James 2:19 says this. You believe that there's one God. Good. Even the demons believe that and shudder. You believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of Man? So does Satan. So they've seen more than a simple belief in Jesus is required. I'm not going to attempt to contradict John 3:16, but instead tell you maybe it should be expanded. In Matthew 11, there was a time when Jesus' dear friend Lazarus died, remember? And Jesus went to Bethany and was with Martha, the brother, the sister of his beloved friend, Lazarus. Now, Martha was a Pharisee, and you know, I know, because she said, Jesus said to her, he said, he will rise again. She said, I know on the last day. That Pharisee believed, I know on the last day. Jesus said it, and you never heard the scripture quoted in this way. This, every funeral you've ever been to has the scripture. She says, I know he'll rise again on the last. He says, no, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever, listen to this, whoever lives in me and believes in me will never perish. So the simple belief needs to be expanded. So when John 3:16 says, and believes in him, the context of John, of the Nicodemus story, what's the context of it? I've said it enough times that you have to be born again. So when you say believe in him, the supposition is that you also have been born again. I hate to preach about hell, but the Bible does say there's only one alternative to heaven, and that's hell. There's nothing in between. It's heaven or hell. God says that every person will stand before him. I preached about that not too long ago. Remember that you're standing there in front of this great big bench of God, who had that dream? That you're standing there looking up at God. In Matthew 25, Jesus said, we'll be separated like the sheep and the goats. And one in everlasting life with God. That's us, that's me, because I'm going to be a sheep. But the goats, and the other into unending darkness and despair, weeping, wailing, and gnashing of teeth. You don't have any choice of whether or not you'll be physically born. That just happens by your parents' will and God's grace. But whether or not you're born again, whether or not you're spiritually born, was and is up to you. Preacher, you've been going on and on about it. Born again. You know, I'm a Christian. I believe. What do you mean, born again? What is that? Born again is when you are in relationship with your Jesus. When you recognize that Jesus died on the cross, not for us, but Jenny died on the cross for you. Carol, for you. And your relationship is that I know that you died for me. All of my sins, I am so sorry for. Lord, would you please forgive me of my sins? Come into my life. Change me. Be my personal Savior. That's born again. Paul said in 2 Corinthians 5:16, if anyone be in Christ Jesus, is a new creation. The new has come. The old has gone away. Being born again means being not saved. Being born again means being changed. That's being born again. And whether you are that, whether you sit in a pew here for 58 years and never make that decision, it's totally and completely up to you. I've made that decision 56 times. I do it all the time. I renew with Jesus. That's being born again. You know, today might be a good day to be born again. It might be a great day to begin your own eternity. When does eternity start, by the way? When you die? No. It starts at the instant that you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. You are then in eternity because your eternity is guaranteed from that moment on. Is it time to surrender your whole life and say today, God, give me a fresh start. No matter what you may have done with God in your life, before tonight. No matter what you believe your relationship with him has been up to this day, maybe today is the time for you to either renew that relationship or for the first time to be born again in the Spirit of God. And then allow God to do a transforming work in you that will last for eternity, never ending. We don't do altar calls in Methodist Church usually, but if anybody wants to come forward or remain in your seat or maybe just stand, and for the first time, or maybe for a renewal, stand with me and let's pray to God. If you want to stand. You can say these aloud or just in your mind, and if for those in the parking lot and those online, Lord, I am so ready to be born again. I want to be all you created me to be. And I want to live with you forever. I know that you are the Son of God. And Lord, that you died for my sins. Lord, I'm sorry for my sin, and I turn from my old life and towards the cross, where you died in my place. Lord, I ask for, earnestly ask for, and freely accept your forgiveness. I invite you to come alive in me by your Spirit. Lord, I am born again in you. I invite you to go out on the first moment of your eternity today. Go and love and be loved by your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And it's in his name that I bless you. Go with peace. Amen. Thank you.
real good food vendor. He used to bring the long cases. And he's leaving, and he's got the first then my not sell it, I'll cut it for you, or give it to you.
It's a good day. It's a good day.
Every day is a good day. Especially when the sun shines.
Yeah. We're awake to see the sun.
Now, a year ago, I couldn't put my leg up like that.